We often waste a lot of energy and time trying to chase down symptoms of what we're struggling with. In this episode, we want to talk a little bit deeper. We want to get to the root system. Let's get more to the why that drives a lot of our battlegrounds and a lot of the struggles that we face. Hello, I'm Mark DeJesus. Welcome to Transformed You. I'm here with my wife, Melissa, and we are going to be sharing about getting to the root of your struggles and battlegrounds. Of course, we're not going to, this isn't like the solution to every issue that you're facing, but one of our deep convictions and passions is that when it comes to heart transformation and it comes to getting and experiencing the change that God can bring into our lives, we have found that all of us can tend to chase the symptomatic struggles that we're facing and not really get to the root issue, which is really driving so much of it. So we spin. And we'll get into some of the branches, and maybe you'll find your battleground in this episode that will be an encouragement to you. But where could we start? I think what prevents us from really dealing with the root issue in our life?
Well, we see hot button issues that we have, whether it's, you know, an issue you have right in front of you with a family member or a work situation. We focus on what we think the problem is. If I could just fix that, then everything else will fall into place. And really, in life, it's a culmination of a lot of things that have happened that have brought you to this pain point that is signaling, okay, no, there's some stuff to deal with here.
Wouldn't it be so much more helpful in our life if, when we see something that we're struggling with, a battleground, either in a relationship, a habit, a way we respond, a struggle, an internal struggle, that if we'd stop and say, okay, what's underneath this?
Right. How did I get here? How did I get to this point that I'm struggling so much with this one issue?
Yeah. So I think what prevents us is, I think first what we're saying here is we rush quickly to just try to find a solution.
Yeah.
And we don't stop and go, wait a second. There's a root issue going here. You know, I'm not a gardener, but we've had to clean weeds. And even when we had our little condo, we had in the back, we had this little stone area that I made, and the weeds would come through constantly. And I learned very quickly, like, I got to go in. I got to not only pluck up the root system, I've got to set this thing up where the roots, the weeds are not allowed in. Right. So I think that we're living in a world where we're avoiding the root issue.
Yeah. And to add more to your analogy is, even when you set up the patio looking pretty, weeds do try to come through, but you can get yourself to a place where you go, oh, I know how to get that out. And you pull it out quicker. And that's where we want to get to.
That's right. That's right.
Because the weeds come.
Right.
And what does it look like to do it healthily?
Right.
And with wisdom.
Right.
Yes. Yeah.
I think sometimes we just get like the weed spray.
Right.
You know?
Because you don't want to deal with it. You're like, oh, it'll kill it. It'll kill it. And that's what we're doing in life. We're like looking at a problem going, oh, let me quickly just put something on it.
I feel like
we could go on with analogies. Going to lead to this.
Well, I feel like as Christians, and this is a common problem that we all need to recognize, is we tend to put a lot of like quick cliche statements on things that don't have any depth to them, and it's that kind of like just a weed spray. When it's like, wait a second. There's some work in the garden that needs to be done.
You got something to deal with here, right?
Yeah. We want to encourage people. There's root systems that God wants to work on in your heart. And I really see, when we talk about the root, we're talking about the issues of the heart. We're talking about the driving treasures, the areas of your life, the things that really affect you. And coming to terms and recognizing that, because that will lead you to greater heart health, greater heart awareness.
Yeah.
And so I think that's the start. I got to really want to go deeper.
Right. That is the big thing. But there are, I think, some other reasons why we want the quick fix, don't you?
Yep. We don't want to face the pain. We're like scared of pain. We're very scared of pain. And
do you think people think that, though? Like, no. I don't.
No, I don't think they consciously think.
People don't, well, I don't, what do you mean? What do you, you know, people kind of like get a little arrogant about that. You're not consciously thinking, wow, that's too painful. I don't want to go there. Some people do who are in touch with their feelings, but people don't consciously think that. They're used to just shoving it.
Yeah. We're so conditioned to just
kind of. We are. There's a conditioning that we do have of not facing things.
Right. We avoid pain. We move towards comfort as quickly as we can.
Correct.
I want to feel good. I want to feel nice. I want to feel. So if that means not thinking about that issue for now, fine. And I understand that. It's. I'm not advocating just, you know, be in pain all day. But I think that there is so much golden value in going, what's this pain about? What's here? I think a great deal of pride, stubbornness, defensiveness keeps us from it because we're shame-based as a culture.
Right.
That there's a lot of shame interactions and in how people talk and how people interact with each other. So who's going to want to like get some help or like share what they're going through? I think that's, if we can rid ourselves of that, every problem would be so much easier.
Yeah. A big one that I think for myself, I came to understand in when you and I got together is I didn't have a reference of what it felt like to really deal with stuff in a healthy way and how good it felt to do that. I don't think most people have a reference. They're scared because there's an unknown factor. So we grow up in families where we don't deal with anything. We don't talk about anything. And so that feels, it's very uncomfortable and it's very unknown. When you and I started to handle things, I was coming into my own ways of God showing me things and healing that I needed, and you were on your path and we came together. But you had a really great understanding of how to talk things out and work things out that helped me to then give me a reference point for what this feels like. Does that make sense? I don't think a lot of people have that understanding that, wow, when I resolve this and tackle it head on, there's relief that comes. There's wisdom that comes. I just think a lot of people walk around going, nah, bat that away. I don't want to deal with it. Bat that away. I don't want to deal with it. But there is really good fruit that comes from facing things and tackling them head on that I think people are really afraid of.
It was very relieving. I think.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. I think it was very relieving for us to, A, have that safety, but also realize there's a reason why I do the things I don't want to do. You know,
yes.
The things that I'm, you know, like
there's
Paul,
the wisdom coming. Yeah.
Like Paul said, what I want to do, I don't do. What I don't do, I want to do. That whole, you know, dialogue. A lot of us relate to that. And I think that realizing there's a reason that's there. It's sin-based, it's broken-based, it's enemy-based. But when I can invite God into that place, now I can get free. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't mean I'm just going to snap it. Like we sometimes think, well, if I get to the root, it's just going to snap into place, everything's going to happen. No, it's more process-oriented because you clip a root there and then you go, oh, to follow the analogy, I clipped that root and then I went, oh, there's another one, there's another one, there's another one,
right.
You know? And but it's still the more fruitful way to go about this. But I would say that gave our marriage wouldn't have had a chance if we didn't have that perspective.
No.
Because then you can't process anything. You can't deal with anything. And I think one of the things that made me so attracted to you in a spiritual way, no. if I can say that. I mean, besides I was attracted to you physically, that we had great conversations together. We had good values.
And any single people looking for a spouse, it's really great when you have the same things you can laugh at.
Yes, that's true. Besides that, I sensed a great hunger. There was a teachability about you that you were hungry. I'm not saying like teachable for me to teach
right.
you. You were just in general a like open heart to go, I want to learn. I want to deal with stuff. I want to grow. And I feel like that is the biggest hindrance. That if we don't present ourselves as teachable, open to listen and hear from people that have a good perspective on us or on certain subjects, if we lack that teachability, then we're gonna struggle in being able to walk the healing journey that God has.
Yeah, I agree with you. There was a place that I feel is super important when you're looking for even a spouse or with your spouse, if you want to start breaking through some things, like simple things, you go to church together and you're like, hey, how did that sermon affect you? Start breaking things down together and talking things out and start opening up these areas of conversation, because that's huge. That is huge. With friendships, spouses, whoever's close in your life, like those are the things and those are the conversations that's going to start helping right. you go, oh, wow, okay.
Totally.
I see that in me and start having that dialogue of like what's, whether it's with someone here physically or with God in prayer, of what does that look like for you to start digging deep into these areas in your life?
Because that's going to help what we're talking about here, where we're taking this episode, because we have found that the majority of issues that people struggle with, battlegrounds they face, the root system, if you want to get to the root, people ask that a lot. What's behind this? What's driving this? What's the root of this? You know, that's a common question people ask. The biggest root system, if you want to go down to the bottom, is a rejection root. It is that place in your life where love has not had its deeper work in your life. And as a result of that, everything else suffers, and these symptomatic things that you battle continue to take place. Yeah. And so we've been on a campaign for years because, you know, and I forget if I shared this. I shared this in the last episode, just kind of the genesis of how I began to discover and I kind of saw this root, and I began to like see it almost as like a weedy, destructive tree and all these branches. And I began documenting this and really go, oh, it leads to this and leads to this and leads to this. And it helped me, but it was also like taking the red pill in the Matrix, you know?
Right.
The red pill is the one that goes in.
I can't remember. I think it is.
And the purple bluish one is the one you just go back to normal.
To normal, right.
And I think the analogy is very true. And people have told me, once I've read your book, once I've gone through that, it's like I can never go back. Now I've seen the system that drives our broken behavior.
Yeah, and how do you ignore it? I don't know. Once you start to get illuminated to it, it's hard to turn around. It's really hard because you see the fruit. Now it's painful and it's hard, but man, I don't want to live back there.
So tell me.
That's denial and ugh.
You were going to say something.
No, I wanted you to go because I feel like the statement is important, because I really do feel like that there's a lot of confusion when you use the word rejection. And I want to really help people today have some clarity and understanding this battle. Because I do think that when you say the word, people go, nah, I don't have that. I think we're very naive to understanding how this battleground works. So could you just do me a favor again? And I want you to say it slowly, say it good. Sum up rejection in one sentence. You just kind of said it, but I'd like, and I feel like people could skip over it because of the way you had it in the, like, if you could just say it, so that people understand, and I want to kind of launch a little bit off of your statement.
Yeah. Rejection is a mindset that separates you from and distorts your sense of love, identity, and relationship.
Woo. Okay.
So it, just that statement.
Yes.
It could be big. It's a mindset. It's so big. When we're talking about the enemy's infiltration, sometimes we look at as like a specific attack, or if I just kind of, you know, I want to help people to move into a more fruitful perspective and look at it as mindsets. It's like, this is like a way of thinking where in this area, man, love just flows powerfully in your life. And you go over to this area and it's like, it's tough.
Mm.
That's what I find in most people. Like, they can be in a certain setting, they can feel fruitful and they can just kind of flow. And then in another area, maybe when they're by themselves or maybe when they're in a certain setting, it's like all kinds of things come into play that are hindering their ability to just know, hey, I'm loved, and be able to love freely, love themselves, love their neighbor as themselves, receive that love from God. So when that gets like compromised in any way, and the reality is because of the sin in our generations, the traumas and dramas, the experiences, the agreements we have, all these things are piling up, reinforcing rejection's work to keep us from just landing in the power of God's love.
Yeah.
So therefore, we don't know who we are. We're insecure. And then our relationships are affected by that. Our potential in relating to people gets affected by that. So you can take the thing about this subject is you can take it into so many different avenues. And so if you first start to realize, okay, I have it, God, reveal to me where I have this, then you can start doing business with the battlegrounds you face, which no battleground you have is just unique to just you. You're not the only person struggling with the battle that you have. I'm going to just lay it out to you. Your battle is common to others, and it just maybe has certain nuances to it.
Yeah.
But the root system of bondage is the same.
Yeah. When I think about rejection, especially for myself, I think about how unsafe I always felt in relationships, which then made me really goofy around people. Whether personalities would come out because I'm like, oh, I could, if I'm funny with this person, then maybe they'll like me. Yeah. Or with this person, if I get stern and sarcastic, then maybe they'll like me. I would form all these personalities with different people to kind of like, in a lot of ways, it's kind of like putting plaster on holes on the wall. Well, if I can just patch this right here, I'll get back to it. I'll sand it, but I'll just patch it and not look at that hole. And I think that a lot of us do this and we're not understanding where, or not really recognizing where the foundation of love, safety, security, identity, like you're saying, was not properly built. And now we're walking around just hot messes, interacting and hoping that we're going to meet that person that's just going to make us feel love, safe, and secure. And it starts with healing all of that stuff inside of ourselves.
You bring up a good point in that rejection can have a major influence in forming our personality.
Yeah.
So before we're even able to recognize this, we're kids, we're young, and it's like when that unconditional love isn't set as a foundation, then there's things that form out of it. And personality is difficult because the subject of personality, we kind of see it as, John Eldredge says it very well. He says, we look at personality as amoral. In other words, it's just fixed. This is how you're wired. And it's like an untouchable area, right? It's like, well, my personality, it's like, wait a second. Sin and the enemy's camp can have an influence on your personality. Mm-hmm. So when you're young, you kind of feel like you don't feel that secure love. You start making jokes and you get affirmation off of making jokes. So then this becomes a thing of, I'm funny in these moments to feel validated, affirmed. Or the classic one is we become, I'm an achiever. And so we kind of wear that as a badge. And it now becomes a driving force.
Right. Or I'm an introvert and you did that because you didn't rock the boat in your house because you didn't want to get screamed at. So now you've taken on that identity. I'm going to be the quiet one because now you can hide in the room.
Or you become an extrovert, which is like, I'm going to work extra hard in those moments to be the outgoing person, to be, not to say that personality traits are not, are evil. I'm not saying that.
Right.
I take the test. There's, I get a lot of input and a lot of understanding about who I am. But
I'm a weird one. That's a whole other podcast.
Right. Maybe we'll talk about that sometime.
Yeah.
But what I want to encourage people to do is sometimes we box that in and it's impenetrable. It's like, well, I'm an introvert. It's like, you don't have to be all the time. Mm. You know, I like to first start with God's standard of my personality, which is you're a chosen generation, royal priesthood, called out of darkness. You're a people who proclaim his praises. There's a real solid identity there. And then understand nuances of it, that there are certain introvert, extrovert aspects. I get all that. But I think rejection comes in and will want to invade our personality to cope with how we're going to feel safe. Like we're just like in this maneuvering, maybe it's fabrication that people never get to know the real you because there's always this thing that comes out, right? And we could even get into all these different patterns relationally that we fall into constantly, all because we're not rooted in the love of God.
All right, so let's talk about some of those things that we do.
Well,
we've touched on some of them. Let's see, what other things take place when this thing is flaming?
The root of rejection, have its work. Well, one of the primary things that Christians struggle with is having this driving force of trying to do everything right, to It could be labeled as perfectionism. It could be trying to do everything perfect, trying to make sure we're following God's ways, making sure that it can be, you know, that we're checking off our God boxes. We can be very OCD yeah. about it. Our culture is becoming more and more obsessive compulsive. It's a diagnosed issue, certainly, as well, too. And it's coming out of these areas that that have not been healed in the love of God. We evaluate our relationship with God by how much time we're spending with him, right? I haven't spent enough time. That's so I need big, to spend yeah. more time. I need to spend. And we're just like constantly in this cycle.
That is so huge, that one.
Yeah, we struggle to, if people are honest, they struggle to feel like connected to his love.
Oh, yeah. And if I haven't prayed or read the word, I don't feel like I've had to really struggle. I don't feel like I'm worthy enough to pray or ask God for anything because I didn't give him my time. So it's like I had to work out this like equal, like I felt equal, like I did equal enough time for God to give me equal enough time.
Yeah. It's torturous.
It is awful.
Yeah. And so our love cycle gets messed up because we feel separated from God. So then we try to do stuff to get God to love us, to feel that love, to feel that connection. We feel separated from people. So we feel like we got to do something to feel connected to them. We're in this constant unsettledness about ourselves. I would say the growing awareness of mental health battles. If I'm recommending working with someone, I've worked with a lot of people in various mental health issues, from anxiety disorders to panic attacks to OCD to some schizophrenic battlegrounds. Where does it begin? It begins with the rejection root. You got to start with that, because the establishment of love needs to be present. Someone who's struggling with anxiety. And I get, you know, as soon as you bring up mental health issues, you get like the gamut of people's comments and opinions and that there is a spectrum of aspects, spirit, soul, and body, that come into play when it comes to mental health. Right. Yeah. But at the root of it is like, how well are you able to process love? So you can have loving people around you.
Right.
But are you able to really receive that? Do you inside have union with what God's love means in your heart? So a person with anxiety issues, there's a love factor. Perfect love casts out fear. If that 1 John 4:18 is a key aspect of the battleground. Depression is another area. You know, that love needs to have a deeper work. You know, bipolar being a mood disorder issue where your moods are out of whack. When love begins to have that deeper work, it can act as such a power to stabilize mood internally, neurologically, because that's what it does. Love is a confidence builder. It is a peace builder, settles you. It connects you to relationship. It restores, it heals, it nurtures. Like, we're talking about the greatest thing that God has established in our world, and he is love.
Right.
Even I worked pretty extensively with somebody who battled with schizophrenia. I had somebody I worked with who had forms of psychosis in areas. And the goal is the journey of restoring the power of relational love where they can connect to it. OCD is a growing one. In fact, I plan to write entire material and curriculum just on that one issue. Because that was anxiety revealed, actually, that was my greatest battle, was an OCD battle, which both had our struggles with that. That God has done a tremendous work in our life and is continuing to do that.
Yeah.
At the core, rejection doesn't allow the obsessive compulsive mind to settle in love. There has to be a pathway that's got to be figured out through certain compulsive actions. And I think when people listen, if they listen to me talk about OCD, most Christians would kind of go, yeah, I got a little bit of that.
Right. We all do. Please.
Okay.
Sorry, my allergies to it.
So it's, we don't have just like a thought. We're obsessed in it. And then we feel compulsive to fix it, whether we have intrusive thoughts that come in, whether we have certain obsessive evaluations of our sin issues, or we obsess over our relationships. It's rooted primarily in the rejection mindset. That's driving it. It won't allow you to be at peace in God's
love.
Yeah,
and the thing that we're so passionate about is the problem with rejection, as it is sabotaging you to interact with every single person around you.
Right.
For most of my life, I have a vivid memory of when it first, my first recollection of when I look back over my life, when I can feel rejection first happening to me. I was 6 years old. My parents had gotten to a divorce for the first time. Yes, they were divorced twice, but that's a whole other story. And I had an incident happen with a neighbor, and I remember feeling frozen because of how they treated me. And it is imprinted in my mind of not feeling safe. And I think a lot of us can point back to those times in our life. The problem is that other things stacked on it, other things to how love was established in my life. They all were an accumulation of ultimately how I interacted with the world. And it sabotaged my journey and a lot of things. And we're very passionate in trying to help you understand how this is ruining and destroying people's lives. And if we can start to get, and we're going to do a full episode on this next week. So please tune in next week on really getting deeper into understanding love. But we want to kind of just get some handles on, okay, yep, this is happening. Yeah, I see that. That's happening in my life right now. And let's start raising the awareness of what this is doing, because it's in everybody's relationships. And it's nasty, and it's destroying a lot of things. And it's even because of the day and age we're living in, especially with text messaging and social media, this thing, I mean, it's lit right now with where it's in people's words and actions. If someone's not responding back, let's just take simple things. Someone's not responding back to you in text message the way you think that they should, or you're reading into things. That's triggering your rejection issues. Right. We are getting triggered on this constantly, especially in the social media age. When someone's not liking one of your posts, you're not secure enough because you're going, who's not liking? I saw that so-and-so didn't like it. I see people arguing literally in YouTube and on Facebook, confronting other people. Why didn't you like my post? Maybe they didn't see it. Right. So now we have, which is a next thing that we could talk about, is these imaginations that rejection creates inside of you.
Creates a whole narrative.
A whole narrative. Mm-hmm. If you could speak to that a little bit, I think it would help people.
I actually want to address something you said earlier about when you recognize as a kid something. I think that, you know, these pain points in childhood and growing up, you have to become like aware of how things affect you in life.
Right.
And culturally, and rejection has influences. Culturally, listen to this statement for a second. We minimize how things have affected us.
So true.
And we overestimate where we should be in our journey. Mm. Does that make sense?
Say it again.
I will.
It's so good.
Because I have to repeat it all the time. And this is a work of rejection.
Yeah.
Because rejection says you should have been better than you are 10 years ago.
That's in the past. You should be over that.
No. Not that. Although
that's part of it, a whole
different subject. I'm talking about you should have been past this 10 years ago. Mm. You should be better than you are right now 10 years ago. You shouldn't have anxiety. You should have been over this. Or you shouldn't be grieving that thing. That's something you should already, you should be over there, but you're here.
Right.
Right? So it doesn't allow you to allow love to say, all right, you know, it's okay that I'm not okay right now. This is where I'm at. It's all right. It doesn't allow that. So you look at the past and you diminish it. Mm. Right? That happened, but I'm fine. You know, statements like, my father never told me he loved me, but I'm fine. My dad was never there, but I'm fine. My mother was, or I had this bad breakup. My wife divorced me, but I'm fine. You know, caught my husband cheating. I'm fine. It's like, really? Mm. So then at the same time, we're beating ourselves up because we feel like we should be further than where we are. Right. This is the insanity of rejection, to keep you like a bobblehead, right?
Right.
Back and forth.
But there's also, if I may add, there's the other extreme of not letting stuff go either. Right. So we have the shoving down, but we also have the other extreme of wanting to go back at it, go back at it, go back at it, trying to make it, because I've had this, especially in friendships, where I tried everything, every song and dance I could to get the person to love me. And it just, they had their own stuff to deal with. So this is where I refer back to my statement of, we all are just walking around acting like weirdos. And it's totally like a bobbly mess of how we're interacting with each other.
We're all goofy.
And we're getting triggered every time we turn around because someone didn't text you or you went by them in the grocery store. You know, we had this, especially when, you know, the church that I met you at, you were pretty popular. It was a big church. And you go through the grocery store and someone's like, "Hi, Pastor Mark. I'm sorry, who are you?" And you can literally see them sink.
Oh, I of, did. Right, right. Of, I didn't
we
know.
Don't know who they are. "I'm sorry, we meet Mark. You were speaking a lot at the time. You're meeting hundreds of people. I'm so sorry. Where do I know you from?" And you can see it come over their face.
Total rejection.
Instead of going, "Oh, right. I know. You know what you mean?" We don't. We don't take that posture. We think, "How did they not know me?" And boom, you're instantly wounded. And this is happening over and over and over again. It's exposing this area of love in our life and safety.
Yeah. Identity. All relationship problems can be healed through letting God heal the rejection wounds in your life.
Yeah.
Help you break those agreements that you have that keep following you and help you shift your narrative. I find it's the biggest work, but it's because when you get healed from rejection, you clear the narrative, God has more access to those areas, and you're able to see things from a healthier standpoint. Mm. You give the benefit of the doubt. You give people room, a more graceful narrative.
So true.
So like if someone didn't like your post, it's like, yeah, maybe they were busy. It's all right. And even if they didn't like it, it's okay. God loves
you. Right. Well, that's the ultimate. If they didn't, you're okay with it, right? that's the ultimate in feeling that peace.
Yeah, because and security. If I have relational wounds, rejection will train me to be very needy so that I pull on people in an unhealthy way. It makes us very codependent. So
that's a good statement. Yeah.
So that's any relationship battle. You want to get to the root of the problem. Now, we also have to keep in mind too that people are not the best friends. They're not working on their stuff. So you getting to the root in your life isn't going to fix all your relationships. Right. It's just going to position you to be healthier. That's all. And I think that's important. Mm. So going back to this love factor, mm-hmm. Let's talk about addictions for a minute.
Okay.
Because I have people write to me a lot. How do I get to the bottom of my addiction struggle? It's got to begin with rejection. I'll tell you why, because any addiction that you have in your life is coming out of, and it can be any kind of addiction, sex addiction, it can be food addiction,
Netflix addiction,
anything,
drug addiction,
anything. There's a pain point, and pain is often two forms, stuff that happened to you that you know, you're still wrestling with or you haven't dealt with, or stuff that didn't happen that should have. That's the pain of emptiness, right? Because a lot of people fall into addictions of just lonely, boredom, emptiness. They don't feel just fulfilled and loved. And rejection's all over that. Here's the problem with addictions. People around an addict can love them, love them, love them, love them, love them. But internally, they have an inability to receive that. So this is why, you know, you can have a whole family gathering around Johnny who's got an addiction struggle and love on him and pray with him. And that night he can go use whatever his drug of choice is. And so this is now allowing God to work on the root system, because many addicts have been trained to numb out to the huge levels of pain that they have. So they're not able to feel, they're not able to connect, they're not able to like grieve stuff they grieve in a healthy manner. It's like they go to the drug thing real quick. Yeah. So if you want to start moving into a new pathway of wholeness, invite God into the root system rather than, you know, just kind of chasing your branches. And I think I can. We all know that doesn't really work.
No.
You
I
know?
Wish it did.
Because there's a hole in your heart where love hasn't had its work yet. And we need to, you know, retrain ourselves. So I just, and we're kind of making a buckshot. Maybe we'll do a whole episode just on that.
Yeah, definitely. But
I think just trying to give you a bunch of areas to go, here's things we've had to work through and things we've had to recognize that rejection, we allow God layer after layer. So even as you go through this resource, it's not just something you one and done it. You go through, oh, yeah, I'm good. No, there's layers. You read that book once and you'll go through like one layer of your life. And then God will reveal another layer. And that's what he does. He works us in layers and layers. Some of you even feel like, oh, I'm going backwards. You're probably not going backwards. You're probably at another layer God is wanting to heal in your life. And one last thought that I had, and just feel free to take it wherever you want to take it. Our constant limitations, where we're like in cycles where we keep running into the same problems and patterns. This is a very common one where you're trying to step out into something and you just keep running into the same resistance, or you feel, I want to encourage people. This is a great time to invite God in and recognize what's the driving thought and pattern that keeps kicking up that I can start doing business with to allow God to heal that so it does not dominate me anymore, whether it's being ignored or whether it's being straight up rejected, whether it's being abused in some form or fashion, or just constantly getting the short end of the stick. These are things to invite God into to go heal this, because you can't work on other people. And sometimes we're exhausting ourselves trying to change circumstances.
Yeah.
Right? We want that mountain to be moved, and we're like, maybe if I scream at it, maybe if I fast at it, maybe if I yell at it, maybe if I do this, and we're just discouraged and tired. Right. Just stop, take a step back and go, God, would you just work on my heart? Help me to just receive your love in the midst of this, and work with me to tear down the walls of rejection that just don't allow that love to permeate my heart and my life. And so, you know, maybe an action step is, what's the hindering mindset I'm dealing with right now?
Yeah.
And what would it look like if I was completely loved by God in that area of my life?
Mm.
What would my steps, my decisions? And then now that forms our thoughts and behaviors rather than rejection dictating your thoughts and
behaviors. That's really good. No, I think that's really good.
Does it make sense?
I absolutely think it does. I think we need to start looking at some of the themes in our lives of where we don't feel safe and secure and loved. And I think that's a great takeaway for everyone today to think about. Next week, we want to really dive into the topic of love in receiving God's love in regards to a lot of these battlegrounds. So think about that. Think about that until next week, about the themes that you're seeing in your life where you don't feel safe, where you don't feel secure, and you kind of keep getting on the hamster wheel in certain areas of your life that you're like, I really would like to see some breakthrough here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And feel free in the comment section to what are some other areas that you find are rooted in rejection that would be helpful to others. Feel free to comment and give us feedback on that. But we do want to highly recommend exposing the rejection mindset. There's a new edition of it. I really encourage you go through it. And it's available in audio, Kindle, and paperback, but there's also a supplemental training course online that goes with it. And I've had great feedback of people getting a lot out of it. I break it down into small video segments that are great for discussion. This book is great for sitting down because at the end of each chapter, there's a prayer. At the end of each chapter, there's questions to ask. And amongst people in your tribe, sit down and go through it.
Yeah, partner because, with people. Yeah.
Because it'll help you to work on how you guys help each other through the process.
Absolutely.
We'll get into more stuff in future episodes. But if this content has been an encouragement to your life, please consider becoming a financial supporter. You can do a one-time donation or join our monthly partnership tribe. By doing that, you get access to a lot of my training courses and materials that can take you deeper, where you're going, yeah, this is the stuff you're talking about is what I'm about. I want to go deeper. Then that's an amazing place that you can join along with us. And it also supports the work that we're doing. You can also take advantage of a recommended tool that we talk about all the time. That's Audible. You can sign up with our affiliate link and you can get a free 30-day subscription, get one free book. At the end of it, you can cancel it, so no worries. But I've been using it for years. I love audiobooks. I do all my stuff in audio format.
Yeah.
And we just want to continue to be a blessing to your life. So thank you so much. You have anything else you want to add?
No, I'm just grateful for everyone's support, and share this episode. Share, because we all got it and we all need to work on it.
Bless you guys. Just be loved today. And I pray you take one step into a deeper depth of knowing God's love for you. So we'll see you next week. God bless you.
Thank you, everyone.